Lord, truly, you are the one who created us. You know us by name. You know the number of hairs on our heads. You are so involved in our lives, even if we don't see you. Lord, you're just there. You know our ways, you know everything. Your word declares there's not a word on our tongue, but you know it all together. You know our sitting down and our rising up. You're intimately acquainted with all of our ways. Lord, you're the one that fashioned each one of us in our mother's wombs, fearfully and wonderfully made. Lord, in your image and your likeness, Father. I just pray right now, your love and your presence, the very presence of Jesus, would just permeate this room right now, and even any person listening by any means, Lord, that your love would permeate their hearts right now. Your healing presence would just touch their bodies. Lord, that you would just come and have your way. Continue to let your kingdom come and let your will be done. Thank you, Lord. Just wait on him for a moment. Lord, we just want to say to you something we should say to you every day, but Father, we just say happy Father's Day to you. Mm-hmm. We thank you that you're our dad, and that you love us. The scriptures could read, for our dad so loved the world, a father so loved the world, that he gave his only son. Mm-hmm. Whosoever would believe in him would never perish but have everlasting life. Father, we love you. We love you. Hallelujah. Well, good morning.
Morning.
Still morning. How are you guys doing?
Good.
Good. I see so many faces. It feels like every Sunday, half our congregation walks out. But that's a good thing. There's young people, kids. My name is Josh. If I don't know you, see a few new faces. Who here is happy it's Father's Day today? Who here's like, eh?
Yeah.
No, really, some of you, eh. It's okay. It's like, who here's not going to put up their hand no matter what I say? It's Father's Day today, so I get to wear whatever I want.
Yeah.
To church. My wife don't get to dress me this morning. So, I'm wearing my Alamar shirt. Oh, wow. You guys. Pardon me?
Double boo.
Okay. How about Jesus?
Yeah.
He told me that his favorite team is the Blue Jays. You know, there's many people that feel like church and the Bible have become irrelevant. But for me, and in my experience, in looking at other people's lives, Jesus makes all the difference.
Mm-hmm.
Look this way.
Amen.
All the difference.
Yeah.
All the difference. Mm-hmm. The Word declares that in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 that you can have everything. Check it out. Like all the money, all the gear, all the fly clothes, all the jewelry, all the electronics, all the cars, all the stuff. You can work your butt off your whole life and make heaps of money and have big houses and everything. We were on a move yesterday. Moving just, you know, it's amazing to see, you know, moving $600,000 homes and $500,000, $700,000 homes in Sarnia. So, I mean, like in Toronto, they'd be like $17 million. But moving these homes, and oftentimes, not every time, but oftentimes, looking at the substance of the people's lives and looking in their hearts and looking in their eyes and just seeing a whole lot of nothing, a whole lot of emptiness. You can have money and riches and fame and friends and popularity and nothing.
Yeah.
Did you know that?
Yeah.
You can have all of that. And I'm not against having money. But you can have it all. You can have it all and have nothing. Jesus put it this way. He said, you can gain the whole world and yet lose your life, lose your soul, lose the essence of the reason you're breathing oxygen, which is not just to accumulate stuff or to accumulate pleasure in your life. It's to accumulate the riches of God. Amen. You can have everything and have nothing. I just felt like I was wrestling over the word this week. And I just first off wanted to say Happy Father's Day and all of that. I've always struggled with preaching messages based on like the day that it is. You know, oftentimes like people are like, are you bringing a Christmas message? I'm like, yeah, I don't know. It's all about Jesus. We'll just bring the word that he speaks. So that's always kind of been the trajectory. I feel like I was at a time this week, I looked over and I looked at a man who I know. He's an older man and he doesn't know Jesus, like at all, as far as I know. And I believe he's an alcoholic. And I looked over at him and he just looked so sad, you know? And my heart started to break a little bit. And I just felt, man, like, what would it have been like? And he's probably in 70 or something. What would it have been like if at the age of 20 or 30 or 40 or 50, if this man, someone had brought him to Jesus? I said, what? I just started thinking, how different would his life have been? Because for me, like, Jesus made all the difference. All the difference. You know, the word conversely says you can have nothing. Nothing. No money, no car, no job, no friends, no following. You know, you can have zero Facebook friends, zero followers on Twitter and Instagram. You can have nothing, and yet you can have everything.
Yeah.
If you have Jesus. You know, left shine. So to me, that's amazing because it shows oftentimes in our culture how short-sighted we become. We're just thinking about this day, this week, this month, this year, which has value to think about this day, this week, this month. But what about eternity? I feel like sometimes we get away from the presence of God. And when we get away from the presence of God, we get away from the things that matter in eternity. Eternal value. Which is what God commands us to look into. And it's so easy, Malia, when you're a young person, because you think you're going to live forever. I mean, you're 14, you're like, no, I'm never going to die. I'm never going to be 20, then you're 20. And you think, geez, I'm never going to be 30, and you're 30.
Don't.
Are you going to be 30? You're going to be 30. How old are you, Josh? 25. Oh my gosh, you are so old. I saw my wife the other day. We were talking about someone. I said, how old is she this year? She said, 25. It was her birthday. Her cousin was turned 25 yesterday. And I said, wow, 25. I said, you're 25 this year. I'm like, my wife, you're so old. But when you're 25, come on, when you're 25, like, you don't ever think you're going to be 40. Are you going to be 40 one day? No. Not tomorrow, she said. When you're 40, you never think you're going to be 80. But this, looking at this man, I started thinking, man, what would it have been like if Jesus had have entered his life somehow, some way? And just this phrase came to me, enter Jesus, enter Jesus. And I'm like, thinking about this, Mark, I'm like, you know what? Enter Jesus into a life and the whole trajectory, the whole the whole path, the whole direction of a life just changes, doesn't it?
Yep.
Sometimes for the good, sometimes for the not good, but it changes. Because one thing you can't deny about Jesus, I mean, he was either a lunatic or he's the Son of God. There's really no in between here. I mean, he changed BC into AD. There's over 2 billion believers in Jesus on planet Earth today. One out of every 5 people or more believe in Jesus. Or probably everybody in the world acknowledges that he existed.
Yeah.
But who is he? But enter Jesus into a life, and then everything changes.
Yeah.
Everything changes. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking, man, like, was there somebody that Jesus asked to talk to this man, and they just wouldn't push past that fear? Was there somebody that, did somebody ever take that man's hand as a young person and say, man, we're coming to church. Let's go to church. I never feel bad about dragging people to church, Duval. Ever. I dragged Duval to church this morning.
Yeah.
But I don't feel bad about it because I'm like, what could happen if he received and his life was changed by the presence and power of God? Let's look at John chapter 8 for a moment. John chapter 8, just one verse, verse 12. And I want to talk about some people here in a minute. We're going to gossip a little bit.
Yeah.
Church, in a good way.
I remember when you threw me in the trunk to bring me to church.
Did I throw you in the trunk to bring you to church? I probably didn't. I had to throw you in the trunk. There was just no room in the car, so you just threw me in the trunk. No, I would do anything.
Let's say you're so.
John 8, verse 12. It's again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
Yeah.
End quote. Oh, guys, there is so much power in that statement.
Yeah.
You know what that basically says? Every problem that you're facing in life, every situation, every circumstance, it has one solution. Follow Jesus. Because you could tell me all the multitude of your problems. And some of you do. And there's only one answer. You say, it's so simple. Obviously, sometimes there's books we can read, knowledge we can get. But the answer is follow Jesus. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. See, every problem that you face, every problem that our society faces, it is an issue of darkness, it's an issue of ignorance, it's an issue of deception, people operating with mindsets of deception, people believing lies about God, believing lies about themselves, believing lies about others, and it wreaks havoc on our society. And so what we need is we need the light of Jesus to shine.
Yeah.
How does this light shine? When Christians pray and when Christians preach. That's the only 2 ways it happens. When believers open their mouths in some way and begin to let the light of God out. Gail was telling me the other day, she led Alpha for 8 years. What is that? That's a method. That's what you're doing is you're preaching and you're praying. You're praying and you're preaching. Come on.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why you're here today. You've got a measure of the truth and the light of God in you. You tasted and you saw, Max, that the Lord was good.
Hallelujah.
But I'm preaching this. I want to preach this message, Enter Jesus, just for a few minutes. I'm, like 50.
3-hour service today. Let's go.
Yeah.
Father's Day special.
I want to talk first about the life of Paul. And I want to share 4 other people's lives really quickly and just demonstrate the course change that Jesus makes. Go with me to Acts chapter 26. Acts chapter 26. There's a guy called Paul in the Bible, who wrote 13 books of the Bible. It's a little summary of his life. When Saul of Tarsus, who was later renamed Paul, saw the resurrected Jesus Christ on the Damascus Road, Saul converted to Christianity. He made 3 long missionary journeys throughout the Roman Empire, planting churches, preaching the gospel, and giving strength and encouragement to early Christians. Of the 27 books of the New Testament, Paul is credited as the author of 13 of them. While he was proud of his Jewish heritage, Paul saw that the gospel was for the Gentiles as well. Paul was martyred for his faith in Christ by the Romans about 64 or 65 AD. So Acts chapter 26. Paul's in prison and he's before a high Roman counselor, a king. He said, "So Agrippa said to Paul, 'You have permission to speak for yourself.' So Paul stretched out his hand and made his defense. He said, 'I consider myself fortunate that it is before you, King Agrippa, I am going to make my defense today against all the accusations of the Jews, especially because you are familiar with all the customs and controversies of the Jews. Therefore, I beg you to listen to me patiently. My manner of life from my youth, spent from the beginning among my own nation and in Jerusalem, is known by all the Jews. They have known for a long time, if they are willing to testify, that according to the strictest party of our religion, I have lived as a Pharisee. And now I stand here on trial because of my hope in the promise made by God to our fathers, to which our 12 tribes hope to attain, as they earnestly worship day and night. And for this hope I am accused by Jews, O King. Why is it thought incredible by any of you that God raises the dead? I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things in opposing the name of Jesus of Nazareth, and I did so in Jerusalem. I not only locked up many of the saints in prison after receiving authority from the chief priests, but when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. And I punished them often in all the synagogues and tried to make them blaspheme. And in raging fury against them, I persecuted them, even to foreign cities.'" Enter Jesus. "In this connection, I journeyed to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests to persecute Christians, to kill them, to throw them into prison. At midday, O King, I saw on the way a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, that shone around me and those who journeyed with me. And when we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew language, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads.' I said, 'Who are you, Lord?' And the Lord said, 'I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and stand upon your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you as a servant and witness to the things in which you have seen, and to those in which I will appear to you, delivering you from your people and from the Gentiles to whom I am sending you, to open their eyes, so that they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, and they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in my name.'" Whew. "Therefore, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first to those in Damascus, then in Jerusalem, and throughout all the region of Judea, and also to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God, performing deeds in keeping with repentance. For this reason, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. To this day, I have had the help that comes from God, and so I stand here testifying both to small and great, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would come to pass, that the Christ must suffer, and that by being the first to rise from the dead, he would proclaim light both to our people and to the Gentiles. And as he was saying these things in his defense, Festus, another king, said with a loud voice, 'Paul, you're out of your mind. Your great learning is driving you out of your mind.' Paul said, 'I'm not out of my mind, most excellent Festus, but I'm speaking true and rational words. For the king knows about these things, and to him I speak boldly, and am persuaded that none of these things has escaped his notice, for these have not been done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know that you believe.'" Paul's preaching, he's convincing, he's extorting, he's just going for it. "And Agrippa said to Paul, 'In a short time, would you persuade me to be a Christian?' And Paul said, 'Whether short or long, I would to God that not only you, but all who hear me this day become such as I am, except for these chains.'" Whew. Sorry to shed a tear or two. "But I was once in darkness, deep darkness. I was so lost. I was so broken. I didn't have vision. The highest aim of my 16-year-old heart was to become a drug dealer. That was the trajectory I had chosen. I was on my way to renting an apartment. I was probably end up getting thrown in jail 5 months later. At 16 years old, I was starting to hang around drug dealers, and we were just starting to get into a little bit of the... My friend had just picked me up and drove me to a prostitution house, I'm going to call it. Prostitute in every room, and drugs, and guns, and... Yeah. Enter Jesus. A couple weeks later, I have a very similar... I cry when I read this story, because... I have a similar story. No one ever preached the gospel. No one ever preached the gospel to me. A couple kids in school invited me to their youth group and stuff. Maybe someone did preach the gospel to me a little bit. But not a clear message. But I did go to church as a young person. Didn't really believe too much. But I was walking home from a bush party one night, and Jesus stopped me. And I was high as a kite. And he stopped me in my tracks. And I couldn't move, Javelle. And the presence of the Lord came, and God spoke to me in an audible or an inaudible voice, and he said, "Son, what are you doing?" I said, I tried to shake it off, took two more steps. God said, "No." He said, "This is your last chance. You're either with me or you're not. Make up your mind." The visitation was so real. Now, I had a praying grandma, and I believe that had something to do with it. The Holy Ghost would wake up my grandma in the wee hours of the morning. 3 o'clock in the morning, she'd get up, she'd fall to her knees, she'd be weeping with her hands in the air, as in her words, crying out to God for my soul. Her oldest of four grandchildren at the time. Well, those cries, God heard them. He set up the situation, he set up the circumstances. I got radically saved. I ran home to my mom. She thought I was so high that I had just seen a vision. But I've never touched drugs since that day. It's been 17 years. I met Jesus. I started going out to a youth ministry, Pentecostal church, upper room. Some of the kids were picking their nose because they'd grown up in church and it was boring to them. But for me, this was real. And I had my first encounter with God 2 or 3 weeks later. I saw kids raising their hands around me, and I said, "All right, well," I had my sideways hat and my Tupac music in, but I just said, "You know what, I'm going to just raise my hands and see what happens." I raised my hands, and the worship leader at the front, who was had a microphone similar to this in her hand, and she just, Holly, beautiful young girl, just her spirit. She just loved Jesus. And she was weeping at the front, crying out to God. "God, if there's anyone here who has never felt your presence before, just touch them now. God, just touch them now." And I promise you, I had my hands raised up, and the presence of the Lord just came so mightily upon me. It felt like I was sucked up into heaven for a minute. It was so tangible. It was so real. I came back down to earth, and that was God. That was God. He's real. This isn't just a book. It's not just religion. This is the presence of God. And I began to understand, I can experience this God. I can experience this presence. In my bedroom, I learned a year later at a youth conference. Kind of after that, I backslid for a bit. Temptations of the world were calling to me. But I went to a revival in Pensacola, Florida. I went to a youth conference called Fresh Wind, and June Smith taught us that I can hang out with God in my bedroom. I didn't know that. I just was trying to get to church every day. That was at 16, 17. Just get me to church. Anything. Like, I was going to, like, anything. Anything. I was just, any church service, I was there. Parents driving me all around Oshawa, Whitby, Toronto. I was just going to church. And then I realized, holy smokes, I can hang out with Jesus in my bedroom. Got myself a Delirious CD. Cutting Edge. I Can Sing of Your Love Forever. Lord, You Have My Heart. Obsession. Did You Feel the Mountains Tremble? I don't get any of those songs, but I started connecting with God in my bedroom. Oh yeah. I created a glory zone, Kyle, in my bedroom. Okay, my bedroom became a sanctuary. for the presence of God. I believe that angels were very excited to visit my bedroom because it was so saturated. Honestly, I'm very serious. 3, 4, 5 hours a day. As a 17-year-old, you would find me in my room reading my Bible. I love to turn the lights out, totally dark, and turn worship music on, and I'd just be standing there, just worshiping, worship music loud, singing at the top of my lungs, experiencing the glory of God, to the point where His presence would, literally, the glory of God would come into my room and push me down to the ground, and I couldn't even, I just lay on the ground like a baby and just weep. See, it's pretty exciting when you go from darkness to light.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yeah. It's one thing to get a seed planted in you. It's another thing to see that seed begin to grow into a mighty oak tree and begin to provide shelter for us. This is what Jesus said, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. It's the smallest of seeds, but when it grows up and provides shelter for many birds.
Yeah.
Well, that's what God wants a life to be. The kingdom comes in and begins to grow up, and the presence of Jesus and the reality of the kingdom and the spirit of truth grow you up, Ricky, into a mighty oak tree, and you begin to provide spiritual nourishment for others. Snot all over the place now. All the difference. Jesus made all the difference in my life. I haven't even pursued it. I had opportunities to pursue riches and fame and fortune to a degree. Thank you very much, my dear. And I just said, no. I don't want any of it. Yeah. Jesus, I just want you. Jesus, consume my life.
Yeah.
Jesus, have your way in my life. I'm not after just temporal stuff. I'm after Jesus. I'm after obeying Jesus. I don't care what it looks like. I just came to a point in my life, even if I'm wrong, I'm just going to obey Jesus. Even if I miss it, I'm just going to obey Jesus. Even if I look the fool, I'm just going to obey Jesus. Because not long after, Jesus started calling me to preach, and that's a whole different story. It's one thing to experience Jesus in your bedroom. It's another thing to bring Him out into the darkness. Start spreading His light. Mm-hmm. Some people love it. Some people don't pay attention. Some people hate it. It's not up to me, though, is it, Mark? It's just up to Jesus and people. And you got to keep preaching. You got to keep sharing the light. Mm-hmm. Talk about a guy called Mark Fossey for a minute. He shared his story. But he came to a place in his life where he was so empty. He had a godly wife, but the man was a broken mess. He'd lost his job. He'd lost his hope. He was a wreck. I mean, you want to talk about someone in the darkness. So many of you have heard his testimony. And Jesus. He was at the bottom of the barrel, in the muck and mud of life. And he decided, well, I'll go to church and I'll actually listen.
Yeah.
Mark shares a story. The pastor was talking about the plumb line, in the book of Nehemiah, where God takes a plumb line. The preacher said, many times God will take a plumb line to your life and He'll see if your life lines up with truth. And Mark had a vision of his life, and his life wasn't. You know what a plumb line is? It's a weight on a string that goes right down to measure the straightness of a wall. Because you want to erect the walls of your life, straight walls. You know, and God showed him a vision of his life, and his walls were all totally messed up, and that thing was going to come crumbling down. And then in a few short months, the presence of the Lord entered his life. About 12, 13, 14, 15 years ago now, Mark? 19 years ago. The presence of the Lord entered his life. And for the next 6 months, you would find him 6 in the morning, 7 in the morning, drinking his coffee, watching Benny Hinn, weeping every day, reading his Bible opened. Just the presence of the Lord restoring his soul.
Yeah.
restoring his life. So, 11 years ago, he walked into our little church, and we were just a couple of young people worshiping for 3-4 hours every Friday night. Yeah, and Gavin, we are a young person still. You were back then.
Young people, I am.
And God said to him, I want you to join this church. He said, no, Lord. He said, Lord, you ask a hard thing. I want you to join this church. And God showed him that he had a part to play. And he does. He said this at our last encounter weekend. I probably wouldn't be pastoring if it wasn't for Mark Fossey. His obedience to the Lord. You got to take this into your heart. Your obedience to the Lord matters.
Yeah.
Your obedience to the Lord matters. Your obedience to the Lord shifts and changes lives. I don't know if I would be preaching if it wasn't for Mark Fossey's heart, his love for the Lord, his love for me, his obedience to God. Because even 4 or 5 years ago, I came to a burnout stage and I was in a very dark place. There wasn't really any gross sin in my life. There was compromise. There was junk in my life. There's still things I struggle with. How about you? Thank you, Jesus. His mercies are new every morning. But Mark, God called Mark, and we've been laboring together, and he's one of the reasons we're here this morning. But could you imagine if 19 years ago, Mark decided, you know what, I don't want that Jesus. I'm just going to do my own thing. I'm going to climb my own way back. I'm going to be a man's man. I'm going to make my own way. The thing about that is it's a total lie. Because number one, God is the one who gives you your breath. He's the one who gave you your hands to have strength. He's the one who gave you your intellect. You didn't make your own brain to make all that money. God gave you that. He gave you your intellect. He gave you everything. He gives you the breath you breathe. So it's all thanks to him. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's the one who made you. We talk about my wife for a minute. She grew up in a non-Christian home. Parents aren't saved, still aren't, to the best of my knowledge. We're praying for them. The age of 8, a couple down the street, Tim and Sarah Van Rienen. Carly was actually really after the babies. She just wanted to hang out with the babies, but God used the babies to draw her over there. And she started going to church with them. They started bringing her to church every Sunday. Carly gave her life to Jesus at the age of 8 years old because of a Christian couple that bothered to take the time to take a little girl. It's probably like free babysitting too, right? But took her out to church. She got saved at the age of 8. She came to Dunamis when she was 14 and really met God. Met the Holy Spirit in a real way. Life totally changed. She went to the Bethel revival meetings. She thought I was a little weird, though, because I had bleach blonde hair. I was like 23, had bleach blonde hair. I had my legs crossed, sitting down on a bench with my arm around another guy. She's like, what kind of pastor is this? I was just a different kind of pastor. Not in any weird way. But I was just radical. Just wanted to reach people. You know, I often think of what my wife's life would have been like if Jesus hadn't have compelled Tim and Sarah Van Rienen to bring her out to church every Sunday for like 6 years and whatever else you guys went to. I wonder what her life would have been like without Jesus. I dare say very, very, very different. Very different. My grandparents are moving to Sarnia.
Woo!
Woo! know if you've met them before, but they're an Estonian couple. Anyone ever been to Estonia before? Estonia. Estonia is a little country right beside Russia, right beside Latvia, across the Baltic Sea from Sweden. My grandfather was 24 years old when he escaped the refugee camp that the Russians and the Germans were kind of fighting over Estonia at that time. And thank you, Jesus, my grandfather's uncle, Admiral Pitka, actually he is a statue in Vancouver, my great-great-great uncle. A statue in Vancouver. He's also a famous Estonian man. But my great-great-great-uncle, Admiral Pitka, was the admiral of the Estonian Navy. And he helped my grandfather escape. He escaped to Sweden and then later to Canada, where he became a logger. And so back in like the 1940s, 1950s, he was making $600 a week logging, which was tremendous money back there. Within a year, he bought a house cash and just did all this stuff. My grandfather didn't know Jesus. Didn't care about Jesus. Just a worldly man. His sister and her husband got saved and dragged him out to a revival meeting. He didn't want to go, but he went. And I think he didn't like it the first night. And he went back and he got radically saved.
Yeah.
And he remembers, he just said, I'm never going to smoke again. And he threw away his cigarettes and he threw away his alcohol. He threw away his partying life, what he was doing. At the age of 30, he said, I want to give my life to Jesus. And so he's been faithfully serving the Lord for 61 years. At the age of 30, my grandmother was just 19 at the time. And she was asking God for a husband. And she had a vision at the age of 20, or 19 or 20. She got off a train, and a man in a dark suit was walking toward her. And she knew that was her husband. She had a vision. So she was from Toronto area. My grandfather was living in Vancouver at the time. And she went to visit some Estonian relatives in Vancouver. And she got off the train, and guess who was there? Jesus was my grandfather was there. And she just knew. Before she met, within 2 weeks they were engaged. Within like 2 months they were married, and they've been married for 59 years. We'll be coming to this church soon.
Yes.
Awesome.
Got to hear the testimony.
Jesus changes people's very lives. He just changes their lives. He also turns off their phones. But he changes. He changes lives. I don't know where even I would have been if my grandfather hadn't have gotten saved.
Yeah.
If his sister hadn't have dragged him out, kicking and screaming, to a revival service, where would he be, Mark? Probably dead because he was a chain smoker. I don't know, where would I have been? Would I even exist? Except in God's heart. I don't know. All I know is Jesus saved his life. Jesus got into his heart. He threw away his worldly ways. He started pursuing Jesus. Even after he retired at the age of 80, he became a pastor of his little Estonian church. And he pastored for about 8 years. You walk up into his study, and there's his little desk with all of his notes, all these translations of the Bible, all of his Christian books. Just a man of God. Years and years of pursuing Jesus. countless lives changed. They just sold their little, not little house, but their moderate house in Toronto for like $1 million. $850,000, pretty close. Just a cash offer. First offer that came, they sold their house. They're moving here into a bigger house for $325,000. That's the way it works. You know what? The blessing of the Lord makes rich, and He adds no sorrow to
it. Praise God.
I tell you guys, I was going to preach this morning about filling our city with Jesus. Because our city needs Jesus. We don't need religion. We don't need just to Bible thump people, although I'm not really against that too much. You just Bible thump me. Yeah. You need it. If it's done out of love. But I just feel like our little church has the potential to make Jesus real to a whole city. In partnership with all the other churches and believers in this city, and I think we're anything special. I think Jesus is special.
Yeah.
And I think when we focus on Him, and when we lay down our lives before Him, He truly begins to lead us. He changes our whole lives. He restores our hearts. He restores our relationships. Not always easy. Because you got to walk, you got to embrace the truth. But He changes everything. I just think there's some people in here that this morning, today, Father's Day, 2016, God is calling you to make a decision to invite Jesus, to ask Jesus to be the King of your life, to be the Lord of your life. I promise you, it doesn't make life easier. It's not just a free ticket to heaven. He is life. His ways give life. If you do life Jesus' ways, you get Jesus' results. Blessing, favor, honor. If you do life your own way, you get your own results. Broke, busted, disgusted. You might have money, but it doesn't matter if you're spiritually bankrupt. So I just feel like the Lord put on my heart, there's at least 5 people in this room, and there's many more watching, or that will watch this message even years to come. But there's at least 5 people in this room, and you know, I need Jesus. It's not even a matter. I want to get some t-shirts made that just have a finger pointing that say, you need Jesus. Yes. It's like not the option. It's not like, oh, you want a little bit of a better life? Try Jesus. It's not a matter of trying it. Well, let me see if He fits. He won't fit into your life. He'll invade it. Yeah. He'll mess everything up. Maybe He'll mess your plans up. But I tell you, the plans of God are better than the plans of any man. The greatest plan that you can fabricate for yourself. Write it all out. Your 10-year plan. This is my 20-year plan. Scrap that. Jesus. Yeah. Jesus. Frankie, His plans are better. Yeah. He says, my ways are higher. You know what Isaiah 55 says? Seek the Lord while He may be found. Here's the word for you, baby. Seek the Lord while He may be found. Call upon Him while He is near. Let the wicked forsake his ways and the unrighteous person their thoughts. For my ways are higher than your ways, My thoughts are higher than your thoughts, says the Lord. If today is your day, and you just know, and you'll know because your heart's going like this, and Jesus is just like, all right, here I am, I want in. And you're all like, what will people think about you? Everyone here is going to clap. I don't know what your family will think. Maybe people think you're crazy. They thought Paul was crazy. They thought I was crazy. Everyone thought my grandpa was crazy. People probably thought Mark Fossey was crazy. Carly's family still thinks she's crazy. But guess what? Life. Life. Life.
Yeah.
I am the light of the world. He who walks and follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
Come on. Praise his name. Hallelujah.
So if that's you, just raise your hand. If that's you, just throw up your hand right now. Throw up your hand if today is your day that you need Jesus. Ricky, come on. You already have Jesus. I want you. You got him. Thank you. You can put your hands down. I'll pray with you in a moment. I just feel like there's two more. It's up to you. It's up to you. Nobody makes you receive Jesus, but if it's you, even if you're like, man, I've been away from God, and I just want to give him my life. Thank you. Put your hand down. Thank you.
Jesus.
Thank you.
Jesus.
Anyone else? Hallelujah. Today's my day. I want to invite Jesus to be the Lord of my life. Jesus. Call on his name and be saved. Jesus. Okay. So if you put your hand up, just stand to your feet right now. I won't pray with you.
Hallelujah.
If you put your hand up.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Close your eyes for a moment. You've got your people up here who are standing. Close your eyes. And someone around them, just get your hand on them real quick. Get your hand on them real quick. Just get it. Not like you don't just surround them. Like a pack of wild animals. Just say this with me. You're standing up. Just say this with me. Lord Jesus, this day, Father's Day, 2016, I give you my life. Save me from the penalty of my sin. Wash me. Renew me. Make me new. Change everything. I invite you, Jesus, to be the Lord of my life, to be my King, to be my God, be my Savior, be my everything. Jesus, I invite you. Holy Spirit, make Jesus real to me. Make the Father real to me. Fill me with yourself. In Jesus' name. Amen. You guys give these guys a hand clap. This is where it can start for you. This is where it starts. Let's pray together as a church, and then we're going to be dismissed. And I really want to encourage you guys. There's a bunch of those Matt Sorger flyers back there on the table. I want you to grab a couple. Grab what you'll hand out. I don't know, is it all of them, James?
Yep.
How many is there?
There's 200.
There's 200 right there?
Starting.
Okay. Grab 3 or 4 or 5 of them. Grab a handful. I'm just telling you, who knows what next Saturday night can bring?
Yeah.
Sunday morning, Sunday night.
It's gonna be awesome.
We're not flying a man in because he's, you know, oh, Matt Sorger, oh, he's so good looking, blonde hair, blue eyes, Dutch guy. Oh, maybe he'll draw the women. No. You know why we invite Matt? Because Matt is going after Jesus. That's why. And when Matt preaches, there's a revelation of Jesus. It's all about Jesus. Why do you bring in preachers? Jesus. Yeah. I think that if they carry some of Jesus, I want to hear what you got to say. Yeah. If you're a preacher and you want to tell me about Jesus, preach to me, baby. I want to know more about Jesus. So So grab some of those flyers on your way out this morning. And the other thing you can do is get on Facebook. Who has said they're going on the event? Okay, you need to get on Facebook, click I'm going, and then sit there and just invite like 20 people or something like that. You know? I tried to invite all my friend list, but it takes forever. I need to still do that. Just clicking down. And so I'm not inviting people who like my friends in like overseas and stuff, but maybe I should though. Hop on a plane from England and just get over here. You know, I think the conclusion of the word today is you can literally have a part to play, a big part, in bringing someone to Jesus. Just like this, the friends brought the paralytic, the four guys, they brought their paralytic friend, they lowered him down through the roof, and the first thing Jesus said to him, he says, son, your sins are forgiven you. And then he healed him. He would have never got there if he didn't have four radical friends that said, hey Jerry, want to go to McDonald's? Yeah, sure. Before he knew it, he's getting lowered through. Hey guys, jeez! I just feel like they might have hijacked him. Threw him in the back of their trunk. Brought him to this meeting, all crippled up, and can't even walk, crippled his whole life. See, there's some people, they can't make it to Jesus because they're so wounded. But you have the strength to pick them up and help them. Isn't that awesome? Oh, there's such an anointing on that. Don't let fear get in there. I pray faith would rise up in your heart. I pray that faith would rise up in your heart. There are some people that are so wounded that they can't make it to Jesus, but you can carry them. Who here just would have loved for a friend to be here this morning experiencing the presence of Jesus this morning? Yeah, they might squirm in their seats a bit. Because we get comfortable in the dark, don't we? Hello. We get comfortable in the dark. The light shines and sometimes it's like, hey Sean. Light. But it's life. Stand to your feet. Let's pray together. Grab your neighbor's hand. Grab your neighbor's hand. Grab your neighbor's hand. You can begin to pray. Just pray quietly. And if you pray in the spirit, if you pray in tongues, just pray in tongues. We'll say, are you Pentecostal church? Yep. We're also Baptist, we're Methodist, we're part of the full Catholic universal church. I don't know what we are. We just love Jesus, and Jesus changes lives. Just pray in the Spirit quietly. Lord, we just love you. Just pray. Just begin to pray, church. Just don't worry about the person next to you. Just begin to close your eyes and just begin to pray. Just begin to pray. Jesus, Jesus, permeate this church. Permeate every person. Young and old, new Christians, old Christians, fresh Christians, stale Christians, permeate all of us, Lord. Yeah. Let your fire, let your presence just come, Lord, and just baptize us afresh. Go get our children. Holy Spirit, just fall on them right now. Yeah. Holy Spirit, we ask you to have your way in this house, have your way in this city. Have your way in next weekend's conference, Lord. Draw people from the north, south, east, and west. We just agree right now just for your presence, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We're seeking you, Jesus. Father, let your kingdom come and let your will be done. Lord, I pray even right now you would heal bodies. Let your presence just let your power just flow. In the name of Jesus, I command bodies to be healed, pains to go. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, we love you, Lord. In Jesus' name. I'll just sing this together just to close this morning. If you don't know it, just move your lips a little bit, fake it. I love you, Lord, And I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Now that you know it, let's sing it one more time to the King. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear, may a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Why don't you give five people a hug and just tell them you love them? You're so awesome.